What'd you say?
Are you ready to come up on the space station with me?
Yep.
All righty then. Stay right behind me. We're going to go up these steps. All right, Akash. Watch your step coming up because you're not floating yet. Welcome aboard the International Space Station, Akash. Come stand right over here for me. Turn around, wave goodbye to your family and friends. Yep. You will see them again, I promise. You know what, though? This would be a lot more fun if we were on the real thing, wouldn't it? Because then we'd be in a weightless environment called microgravity, and we'd be floating. Everything floats, which means you do not have to pick up your room because nothing hits the floor. That's all right, isn't it? But on the flip side, unless you secure all your stuff, it won't stay where you put it. So if you find that you're missing your pencil or toothbrush, you'll probably find your missing items at the end of the day, stuck in one of the filters for the station's air rejuvenation system. Humans in space are like fish out of water. Space is a hostile environment for human beings. So the station has all the necessary life support functions to keep you healthy. Even with all that, the first day or two in space, some astronauts come down with space adaptation syndrome, which is space sickness. So each astronaut gets their own emesis management system. This is a bar fix. Now, gosh, you only have to use your EMS the first day or two here in space, but if you need to use it, be sure to get everything in the bag. Because if you don't, you know what? It's going to be floating around in a module. So, let's say you're really tired and you want to sleep. If you just close your eyes and go to sleep, Akash, you're going to be floating around bumping into switches and other astronauts. Each astronaut gets their own sleep restraint unit just to hold them in place while they're sleeping. But hop in here and I'll tuck you into bed. Hop in there, yeah, hop in there. There you go. All right, there's a hole on the side. Put one arm in there. There's one on the other side. Way up there. Okay, I'm going to zip you in. There you go. Look at that. That's got to be weird sleeping strapped to the wall, isn't it? Yeah, I wonder what you'll think of the top one. Whoa. You have to remember, though, in microgravity, there's no such thing as right side up and upside down. There is no floor, ceiling, east or west. So on the station, you can have astronauts sleeping here, 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 even right where I'm standing. They all feel exactly the same. Akash, I'll tell you, these things are miserable here. But on the station, they're not. The astronauts sleep home. Workout time for you, sir. Hop up here on our dual cycle or gonger. Sit right down there. Sit down there. You gotta work out. And no feet. Just grab the handlebars and start pedaling your arms around. There you go. Keep going. Don't stop. One of the negatives to living in space is that microgravity reduces muscle mass and bone density. And to counter this, the Expedition 52 crew on the station right now has to work out for at least 2 hours a day, keep going now, every day, on a variety of similar equipment, which includes the treadmill and the ARID, the Advanced Resistive Exercise Device, which you see in use in the video there right now. Good job, Akash, you're done. Go ahead and hop off of that. Come stand right there for me, please. Ladies and gentlemen, it is the moment you've been waiting for, the waist hygiene compartment. You know what that is? You know? It's a space toilet. Yes, it is. Now listen, on a real space station, there is a privacy panel that you can close over this area, but this is an educational format, so we do not have that here, which might make you a little nervous since you volunteered to demonstrate this stuff for me. You don't have to do anything. You stay right there. I'm just going to tell you about it. Now remember, there's no gravity to hold you down, so things are a little different. When nature calls, you float over this area, and the first thing you do is really the most important. You start the suction. Yeah. Number two goes in here. It is a pretty small hole, so you want to make sure that you have really good aim and that you let go in the right direction. You want to be on target. And then, Akash, when you're sure you're in the right spot, then you go. Can't use water in the space toilet. We use suction to do the job that gravity does here on Earth. Suction pulls the solid waste away from your body into a container. Later, we dispose of the solid waste, but we save the liquid waste. Water is a precious commodity on the space station, so we recycle all of it. You know what your liquid waste is? It's your urine, your pee. Yeah, it goes in here. Suction takes over for you. And it ends up right here. You drink it. You do. In fact, you drink it again and again and again. Now, doesn't that Still want to be an astronaut? Like, it's not as bad as you think. It goes through filtration and forward osmosis. So what you end up with is totally pure water. More pure than the bottled water we buy here and drink. You just have to get over the mental hangouts, which is the hardest part. Having a closed-loop system will allow us to travel farther. Allow us to go farther in space. And we're already using this technology here on Earth, too. Not just to recycle water, but also to purify water to save lives. All right, Akash, you just use the facility, so here you need to wash your hands. Get your hands good and clean. Since water is so precious on the station, they use antibacterial hand wipes, full-size wipes on their bodies, and a shampoo developed by NASA called No Rinse Shampoo. They do look forward to having a real shower when they get back home, because they miss those a lot. All right, come on down here with me to the galley area. Come on down here. This is where you'd be hanging out with your fellow astronauts, floating around, talking about your day, and preparing your meals. Come on over here. Let's talk about this, because these days astronauts can have all kinds of tasty meals and beverages just by adding water. So Akash, we're on the International Space Station right now, aren't we? Let's try this here now. We're on the International Space Station right now, aren't we? Take three. Akash, we're on the International Space Station right now, aren't we?
Yep.
Yeah, we sure are. Yes, indeed. So since we're on the space station right now, where does the water come from that we're adding to our tasty foods and drinks?
That area.
You're absolutely right. Good for you. Recycle B. Just add water and enjoy.
Oh boy.
Of course, on the station, everything goes floating around. They put Velcro on all the food packages. It's also on their clothing. My favorite part about that is it means you can get all your meals to go. How cool is that, right? Okay, guys, you have demonstrated sleeping, exercising, going to the bathroom, personal hygiene, and food preparation. There's more to your training for today. The International Space Station is not just a place to live. It is a space laboratory for new kinds of research that is impossible to conduct in the gravity on Earth. And you're going to demonstrate how some of this is done, so I need you to stand right here for me. Right there. Perfect. Arms at your side. There you go. Look straight ahead. Very important, do not move. Be very still and scan your body. You are very brave. You're doing an excellent job. Don't move. This does not hurt at all, and I am done. You okay?
Yeah.
I'm glad to hear that. Let's see here. Woo, you did a fabulous job. It came out great. Thank you. Come on over here with me. What I need you to do now is go down the steps and go back to your seat. And the reason I'm sending you down is because from down there you can see a lot better what we're doing with your body scan. So just push on that gate and it'll open up. There you go. But you're not finished yet, okay? Because you have to keep paying attention because you're still in training. All right. While the system is processing Akash's body scan, I think I need to have a sip of this refreshing recycled water. All this talking makes me a little thirsty. Excuse me, sir. I have to undo the straw. Inside the pouch. But if you take gravity away, I want to show you what happens. You see, with gravity gone, surface tension becomes a dominant force. Notice when two blobs of water collide, they merge into each other, forming a bigger blob. Physics appears to behave differently in microgravity. And then when it hits an absorptive surface, like that towel over there, a wicking action pulls it into the towel like a sponge. Well, cheers. Akash, what do you think? You think your body scan's about ready? You think I should go check on it? You stay there. You think it's ready? Let me go see. There we go. Now here's what happens when astronauts like Akash travel in microgravity. The fluids in your body move up from your arms and legs. This makes your face puffy and your legs thin. This condition has a highly technical name, very scientific. It is called
chicken legs.
Your bones lose calcium and your spine expands up to 2 inches. Also, in microgravity, your heart shrinks a little bit. Akash, don't worry about that too much, okay? Once you get back to Earth, your heart gradually returns to normal. But as for the calcium loss and some other things, recovery is a bit more difficult. And that is why our astronauts, like Akash, are such willing test subjects, helping us to understand how microgravity will affect future long-distance space travels. In other words, before we can send humans to Mars, we will have to invent a way to prevent osteoporosis. Biological processes aren't the only things that are different in microgravity. Chemical reactions behave differently too. In fact, I want to show you something else. Well, look at this. Oh, hang on a sec. There we go. Now, notice how a simple candle flame burns here on Earth. You see the shape of the flame? It burns in a teardrop shape. Well, did you ever wonder why? The fire makes the air hot. Of course, hot air rises, and this causes cooler air to rush in to take its place. This process is called convection. And it is what gives flames here on Earth the shape that they have, rounded at the bottom and pointed at the top. But in microgravity, heat cannot rise. So there's no convection, no airflow. Well, then what does it do? As you can see, it burns the shape of a globe instead of like that. And get this, it burns more completely, much cleaner, and more efficiently. Having a laboratory in microgravity will allow us to find out why it does this and how we can get it to do this here on Earth. This is important for future engine designs. Our microgravity research on the physics of combustion will lead us to more efficient fuels and less pollution. As you can see, microgravity is an excellent environment for conducting experiments that we just cannot do here on Earth. I have another example for you too. Here on Earth, it is difficult to combine large amounts of lead and tin. That is because the lead is heavier than the tin is, so it sinks to the bottom. They keep trying to separate like oil and water, but in microgravity, fluids with different densities can be mixed together almost completely. And in this case, it'll lead to improved manufacturing processes here on Earth, resulting in a more stable alloy with fewer flaws. The International Space Station is also a unique laboratory for medical research and development. So let's just say that you are a scientist here on Earth studying a really nasty bug or disease. You would have to grow lots of cells to experiment with. The problem is, in gravity, living cells that are grown outside the human body cannot grow very large before their own weight crushes them and they die. But cells grown in microgravity thrive. They grow quicker, larger, and in three dimensions. This is a huge medical breakthrough. We can now grow large quantities of cells, and the data can be studied by scientists here on Earth. And in the coming years, you can expect to see developments in disease control, genetics,